All right, today we want to look in section 4.4, and in section 4.4, this is some trigonometric models, and some of them are going to deal with, you'll see, we'll look at one problem that deals with the, just went out of my head. Anyhow, we'll look at one thing here. I hate harmonic motion. There, it popped back in. So we'll look at one of those, and we're going to look at some different mathematical modeling here for this section, and some of the problems are going to be not that hard. And some of them, you know, you may think are a little tricky here. But let's start here by getting out of the way a few basic things. And what I want to do is, if you'll look at our sine graph for just a minute, where we know y equals a, the sine of bt plus c plus d. Now, we already know that a is the amplitude. We know that D is our vertical shift. We know a lot of different things here. All right. For example, we know that the absolute value of A is the amplitude. But let's say that they didn't give you your function here. Let's say they didn't give you Y equals A sine of BT plus C plus D. And they gave you a maximum and a minimum point on the graph. They gave you the maximum height and the minimum. Then how you would get your amplitude here, your amplitude would be equal to the max minus the min divided by 2. So if they give you even a graph, you can look at the graph and figure out, find the max, find the min, subtract them, and divide by 2, and that's going to be your amplitude here. All right. Now, we also know that D is our vertical shift. If we did not know our vertical shift, then how we could get the vertical shift, it would be your max plus the min divided by 2. That is how we get our vertical shift here. All right. Now, we also know that the period is equal to 2 pi over b. So I'm going to let p equal 2 pi over b. Let's say they gave you the period, but you didn't know b here, and you want to find b. So we can solve for b here. B would have to be what? 2 pi divided by your period here. So, in other words, to find B here, it is 2 pi divided by whatever period is. Now, to find C, if you ever have a situation where you want to find C, C is equal to 3 pi halves minus whatever b was times x sub 1, where x sub 1 is the x value of the minimum. Again, that would be like if you knew the ordered pair for the max and the min, then the x value of the minimum is what you put here, your b you just found right there, and that's how you find your c here. All right. So turning your book to page 186, and let's look at problem number 12 there. Number 12 on page 186. Now, what you're given here is we have a max of 95, we have a min of 40, and they're telling you that you've got a period of 24. And what they want you to do is come up with your sinusoidal equation here. That's what that's called. I've been avoiding saying that word, sinusoidal. All right. So they want you to come up with your sinusoidal equation. So I automatically can find my, now again, we're wanting to get this. And I'm not having to worry about C because they're not giving me the x values of the max and the min here. All right, so I know that I can find A. It's my max minus my min divided by 2. So this ends up being what? 55 over 2, which is 27.5. Very good. So does everybody see how we get A? Now, to get our D, we add 95 plus 40 over 2, which is going to be what? 135 over 2. So what would be my vertical shift here? 67.5. Does everybody see this? Now, if my period is 24, we know that B is equal to 2 pi divided by whatever your period is. So B would be 2 pi over 24. So what would B have to equal here? Pi 12s. So what would be my sinusoidal equation? 27.5, the sine of pi 12th t plus 67.5. Is everybody with me there? Questions? Anyone? Anyone? So does everybody see this? All right. Turn in your book to page 186, and let's look at the graph there of number 10. Now, the book that I have here is going to have your answer underneath it, so try not to look at my little answer there, because sometimes they're not correct, let me tell you. I've already found several this semester. Now, For this graph here, they want you to find your amplitude. A is state the amplitude and the period. B is estimate the value at x equals 2. And C is estimate the interval 0 to p where f of x is less than or equal to negative 100. All right. Now, the first thing, to get my amplitude, I want to look at my height. Is here at 125, and what is my low here? Negative 125. So what do you automatically know the amplitude would have to be here? 125. Now, if those numbers had been different, what would you need to do? Subtract them and divide by 2. Does everybody follow me? All right, so my amplitude here would have to be 125, and you can see they got that one right. Now, your period for one complete sine graph, what is that period right there? 6. So my period would be 6. Now, the next thing said, try to estimate when x equals 2. So x equals 2 is about right there. Now, if that right there is 125, try to figure out what these little increments are in. Is that 25, 50, 75, 100, 125? So it's roughly, they're in what? They're roughly in 25s, right? So what do you think that right there roughly is? Well, if you're looking for 2, you're going to go up 25, 50, 75, 100. And if you really look right there, it's just really above the mark right there. So that's why they're coming up with about 108. I would have probably said about 105, maybe. 110, something like that. All right, and then what's the last thing they're asking for? Where is this what? Below 100. So here is 100 right here. So where would it be below 100? It's going to be roughly about maybe 3.9 over here to, say, 5.1 or 5.2. Because see, below would be below my pink there, okay? because that would be below 100. And does everybody see roughly it would be about 3.9 maybe there? Roughly 3.9, and then over here maybe about 5.2 or 5.3 or something. So does everybody understand what they're wanting you to do on those? Hey, and they had 3.9, 5.1. We were pretty close. So does everybody see this? All right. Let's look at another problem here. I want you to look at number 32 on page 188. Number 32 on page 188. Right, on number 32 on page 188, what they are giving you here, it says temperature models, and it says in Nairobi, Kenya, the daily temperature in January ranges from an average high of 77 degrees Fahrenheit to an average low of 58 degrees Fahrenheit. Find a sinusoidal equation model for the daily temperature. B, sketch the graph, and C, approximate the times each January day the temperature reaches a comfortable 72 degrees. Assume T equals zero corresponds to noon. So what we want to look at here for Nairobi, Kenya is we know that we've got an average high of 77, which gives me a max of what? So we have a max of 77, and we have a min here of what? 58. And we're looking at, it says, assume T corresponds to noon, and we're looking at over 24 hours here. So my period here would have to be 24, because we're looking at over a 24-hour period here. So now, what we want to find is, we want to find our amplitude and our vertical shift. We can find those first, right? My amplitude here, which would be the absolute value of 77 minus 58 over 2, which is going to end up being what, somebody? 9.5. To get my D, which is my vertical shift, I want to add the two of them together and divide by 2, which is going to give me what? 67.5. Now, my B here, we know, is 2 pi divided by my period, which in this case is 24, so B would have to be pi 12. So for my A part, my sinusoidal equation here would have to be 9.5, the sine of pi 12 T plus 67.5. So does everybody see the A part? Is everybody okay with A? Now, to graph my B part, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go ahead and take into account my vertical shift. All right? My vertical shift is up how much? All right. So I'm going to dot this and say that this is my x-axis here. I'm going to think how wide I want to make them. Now, this right here is 67.5. Does everybody understand? And that's really 67.5 degrees, isn't it? Now, what I'm going to do next is I'm going to say that this right here is 77, and this right here is 58, and we know that this distance in here has to be how much? What do those distances there have to be? What were they? 9.5? So that's 77 degrees, and this is 58 degrees. Now, is everybody with me so far on how I came up with my graph so far? All right, now, if my period is 24 hours, then what would my force be? 6. So this would be in 6 hours, 12 hours, 18 hours, and 24 hours, right? Now, let's be careful here. Now, they're wanting 0 to represent what, somebody? 0 is representing noon. So right here at 0, this is noon. If that's noon, then this would have to be what? 6 p.m. What would this right here have to be? Midnight. And this would have to be what? 6 a.m. And then we would be back at what? Noon. Does everybody visualize what's going on there? Now, how does your sine graph work? Where does sine start at? Here. It's going to go up my amplitude, back here, down here my amplitude, and then back here. So it's going to look something like this, is it? Isn't that pretty cool? Yeah, they reached the peak at 6 p.m. at 77 degrees. Now, you got to think, this is in January, too, so. Look at 6 a.m. is about normal here. We're low, and then we're heating up like they're heating up. And then where we hit our peak around 1 o'clock usually or 2, they hit their peak at 6. So, all right, so now, that's B part. Is everybody with me on the B? Does everybody see how to graph it? Now, C asks for what? What does C ask for? All right, so they want approximately when it's going to reach 72 degrees. So 72 degrees, if that's 77, and this is 67.5, so roughly 72 would be about halfway in between there, wouldn't it? Isn't that about right? So approximately, where does it look like it's going to be above 72 degrees? Maybe 2 p.m. until what? Very good. I'll say 2 to 10. How could you figure that out? Does anybody know? Okay, here's how I did it, because I came up with roughly 2 and 10. All right, put this graph in your handy-dandy graphing utility. Put your equation in, and I'll slide it back down where you can see the equation. Everybody put that in at y equals. Now, you've got your window right here. I would do my min. I would do maybe my min at 55. Well, let's do your X min first. X min should be 0. X max should be 24. And do your increments in, say, 6, because we were looking at it being 6. Your Y min, I would do maybe 55. And my Y max, I would go all the way up to maybe 80. And do it in a scale of 5. Again, this is what I would try for my window right there. 0, 24, 6, 55, 80, 5. And let's see if that shows our graph. So there we have it, right? Looks like ours, doesn't it? Now, what you can do is something you learned in college algebra, the intersect. Go to y equals. And what are you going to put in there at Y2? 72, because I want to know the temperature at when it's going to be at least 72, right? So put 72 in there, and now hit graph. And you have this, don't you? The Everybody with me? So now I want to know, when is it going to be above 72, which would be in this interval here, right? So do second function trace, second trace, and what do you see there at 5? Intersect. So do 5. And let's find this first one very over there close to the y-axis. Let's go all the way over there to that one. Now you see I'm pretty close there, aren't I? Get your cursor all the way over there. All right, hit enter. Hit enter for second curve and hit enter for guess, and what do you get there? 1.88, which is roughly around what time? Around 2 p.m., right? So does everybody see 2 p.m.? Your guess was pretty good there, right? Now, how could I find the other one over here? Do second trace again, 5, and move your cursor over to that intersection point. And when you get it over there, hit enter, enter, enter. And what do you get there? T equals 10.12, right? Does everybody see how you can put this in the calculator and use the intersect function? Isn't that pretty cool? So, where we guesstimated 2 to 10 p.m., when we used the calculator, what did we get? 1.88 and 10.12, so our guess was pretty close there, wasn't it? So, does everybody see number 32 here? It's kind of cool, ain't it? Is everybody all right with 32? All right, next thing we want to talk about here is, get my notes back, harmonic motion. Does that look blurry? Just a little bit, doesn't it? If that works. Oh, boy. Come on, stop it. There, harmonic motion. Now, if you're motion sickness, you're already sick. Now, they talk about harmonic motion here in your book, and I'm going to let you read all that. I'm not going to spend a lot of time going into a lot of detail about it. It starts on page 180, and it talks about... you can see the spring there and releasing springs in figure 4.43 and all of this. And I'll just let you read all that. And what I'm going to do is just kind of summarize a couple of things. Equilibrium is when your weight there is at rest. Your frequency... this is the number of cycles it completes per unit. Now, how you get your frequency, it's one out of your period here. It's one out of your period here, which your period we know is 1 over 2 pi over whatever B is. So what would your frequency end up being here? B over 2 pi here. All right, so turning your book here to page 187, and we're going to look at number 48. Now, number 48, normally your harmonic motion is dealt with a sine curve, but it can be with a cosine, and I'm going to do one here with a cosine. So look at number 48 on page 128 here. It's number 24 on page 187. Brain fart, I'm old. 24, page 187. Does that look better? Okay. Now, what you're given here, it says harmonic motion. The bob on the end of a 24-inch pendulum is oscillating in harmonic motion. The equation model for this oscillation is d of t equals 20 cosine of 4t. Where d is the distance in inches from the equilibrium point, t seconds after being released from one side here. So the d of t there is your distance once it's been released after t seconds here. So A says, what is the period of the motion and what is the frequency of the motion? So for A here, my period would end up being what? 2 pi divided by 4. So what would my period end up being? Pi halves, right? Pi halves seconds, because we're looking at this in seconds, right? Now your frequency we know is what? Is b over 2 pi, so it would be 4 over, is it 4? Yeah, 4 over 2 pi, which would end up being what? 2 over pi. And the frequency, that would end up being what? The number of cycles that it completes. So it's 2 pi cycles per second here. And that's the frequency there of the motion. Now the B part says, what is the displacement from equilibrium at t equals 0.25 seconds? Is the weight moving toward the equilibrium point or away from equilibrium at this time? So now we need to, I want to do a graph and show you what we mean by toward and away here, okay? So we're going to graph this thing. So let's take a minute and graph this. Is it because it's hot in here, y'all are so yawny today? Yeah, I think it is starting to cool off some. Let's say right here, right there. That may be too far, but we'll try those. So if my period is pi halves, then what would my force end up being, somebody? Very good. So that would be pi eighths plus pi eighths is 2 pi eighths, which is pi force. 2 pi eighths plus pi eighths is 3 pi eighths. And 3 pi eighths plus pi eighths would be 4 pi eighths, which would be pi halves. Does everybody agree there? And we're going to say that this is negative 20, and this up here is 20. So what do we know about cosine? Cosine is going to be here, then here, down here, back here, and then up here. I'm hoping that's pretty close. So draw in your cosine graph. Hopefully yours is a little more curved. Now, somebody do for me on your calculator, pi eighths is the same thing as what is a decimal. Alright, and pi fourths is, and 3 pi eighths is 1.1, I'm just rounding to the nearest tenth, and then this one would be 1.57. I'm just getting the decimals there. Now, what's happening here? As we're coming in, you got to understand this thing is moving in this direction here. They already see it's moving in this direction. What's happening right here? From 0 to 0.39, what are you doing? You're moving toward. But what's happening here from pi 8 to pi 4? What are you doing here? You're moving away from. But then what's happening here from pi 4 to 3 pi 8? Again, you're moving toward. And then what are you doing up here? Moving away. Does everybody understand the toward and the way here? Okay, now, so what's happening here, it says at what value? Off the place. B, what is the displacement from equilibrium at t equals 0.25? Are we moving toward the equilibrium point or are we moving away? Tell me that. Where's 0.25? 0.25 is back here, so what are we doing? We're moving toward, aren't we? So we know that, but then they want to know the displacement. So how would I find the displacement here? I would need to do d of what? 0.25. So you'd want to put that in your calculator here. All right, and we said that you're moving toward, right? So what do you get for your distance there? Unless I put that in my calculator wrong, which could be, because y'all know me. (10.81 inches) because we're looking at the distance, right? When the time is 0.25, the distance would be 10.81 inches. So does everybody see B? What does C ask for? What is the displacement for equilibrium at t equals 1.3 seconds? All right, put that in your calculator and tell me what you get. And then tell me, is it moving toward or away? Well, 1.3 is going to be in this interval, and what are we doing? We're moving away from equilibrium, aren't we? So this one would end up being away. And what did you get when you put in 1.3, somebody? Yep, 9.37 inches. Is everybody following me? All right, excuse me, D. How far does the bob move? I start thinking about what about bob? How far does the bob move between t equals 0.25 and t equals 0.35 seconds? What is its average velocity for the interval? Do you expect a greater velocity for the interval t equals 0.55 to t equals 0.6 and explain why? So let's first find how far does the bob move between t equals 0.25 and t equals 0.35. So I'm going to move this. So for t equals 0.25, we already know that the distance there that it moved, and I'll write d of t here, was equal to what? So for t equals 0.35, and I probably should have written it 0.35 in here and 0.25 there. Find that for me in my calculator while I white out and rewrite this. So what did you get for that one? 3 point what? So the distance here that they would have, let me read it. How far does the bob move between those? So you'd want to do what? Subtract them to see how far it moved, right? So how far did it move? So roughly it moved 7.41 inches. Does everybody agree there? Is everybody with me? Now, the next part of that says, what is the average velocity for this interval? Now, your average velocity here, what we want to do here is, when you're looking at average velocity, it's your change in distance over your change in time here. Okay? So, this, in other words, if you had an interval from A to B, then what we would be looking at here would be D of B minus D of A over B minus A. It would be the distance B traveled minus the distance A traveled over the difference between the times here. Does everybody understand what I'm trying to get you to see here? Now, you already found the distance between them to be what? 7.41 inches over my time here would have been what? 0.35 minus 0.25. And what are you going to get here? I got 74.1 inches per second. Oh, y'all were already telling me your denominator, right? Sorry. I was like, how are they getting that? So did y'all get 74.1 inches per second. Now the last part of that says, do you expect a greater velocity for the interval 55.55 to 0.6? Think about this for just a minute. When you look at your graph here from 0.5 to 0.6, really what's going to happen here? What's your graph doing? What would the object be doing? It's going to be slowing down, so I wouldn't expect a greater one because it's going to be slowing down. That's what I would think. Trust me on that. It's going to be slowing down. All right. Have y'all seen enough in this section? You think you can handle it? Is everybody okay here with section 4.4? Everybody okie doke here? Cool.